Good afternoon, dear students. Welcome to another session of Verilog HDL. So in previous discussions, we went through gate level modeling. So which is having the similarity as in we connect the gates which are available on breadboards and then we rig up the entire circuit and see the observations. So the similar kind of thing is done using the Verilog code in a simulation. So there also we saw that how delays can be introduced, how what type of delays are present, so what are the different gates which are available, and how do I go ahead with the gate level of modeling. So in simple and short, first you try to realize what you want to say inculcate in from the logic. Say I want to build a multiplexer. So from that multiplexer, what we have to take down is its truth table. So from truth table, you implement its logical representation, that is logic diagram. So based on that logic diagram, you write down the Verilog code as to see how the interconnections are, what is happening. So those all things you'll be doing. Now, what is the problem with doing coding in such form? That is gate level modeling. What is the problem? Using gate level modeling, what is the problem is, imagine if the circuitry is very big. Say there are thousands of gates which are present in that. Can you imagine what amount of coding will be involved when you are going with gate level of modeling and you should remember each and everything? So which output goes where, what is happening? So this is where data flow modeling comes into help. So slightly upper hand as compared to say gate level modeling. So this is higher level of abstraction or higher level of modeling. So let us see what happens in this case. So one thing just to remember is in data flow modeling, right, you will not be bothered about how the interconnections are happening between the gates. So you will be going little bit upper. Say I want to implement a AND representation. What I do is I make use of operators. If I want to add two numbers, what I do is I use the operator. Say I want to add A and B. So I'll be writing it as, say for example, A plus B. And if I want logical operation, it will be A and B. So directly I'll be using such kind of operators. So which makes coding a little bit easy as compared to the gate level modeling. So now coming down to so that is what you'll be trying to do. So in this process, you'll be making use of what we term as logic synthesis. So these all things we had discussed in the starting module, first module itself. So now here we'll be going through a few of the concepts related to data flow modeling. The first one which comes is continuous assignments. Now, what is a continuous assignment? It is a basic statement which is used in your data flow modeling. Used for what? It is used to drive the value onto the net. That is net is nothing but it is declared using the wire keyword. So basic statement which is used in data flow modeling, for what purpose? To drive a value onto a net. So it is like you have, for example, you have an AND gate, you provide input to this. Now here there is a wire. If you have to drive this, then some changes have to happen and this one should assign some value to this output or the wire which is present. So you're basically trying to drive a value onto the net. In short, what this does is this actually replaces the gates what we have discussed in previous gates, in the sense you are not using any such keywords over there wherein we'll be going for gate level of modeling. So here gate continuous assignment basically replaces the gate in the description of the circuit. So if this gets replaced, right, what happens is coding becomes little bit easy. and it is easy to remember those things. Instead of remembering, say, if the circuitry is very big, then remembering each and everything, which gate gives output and which gate takes that input, so it becomes tedious. So that can be minimized over here. So this is representing, it helps us to represent the circuit in a little bit higher level of abstraction or higher level of modeling. Now, a continuous assignment statement basically starts with the keyword termed as assign. Now, what is the syntax for this one? So here is the syntax, what they have provided. So that this is a continuous assignment, assignment what we have. So keyword is assign. What is the drive strength you can specify? Then a question mark. What is the delay you can specify? Then a question mark and a list of assignments. So this is the syntax. So assign, drive length, delay, and list of assignments. So this is the syntax. What is present? Okay. So let us see at a example over here. So here you can see that we have a continuous assignment, which is keyword is assign. There is out, which is assigned in this one. So let us not bother what is and, what is plus. So what are these things? So one by one we'll be going ahead, because in later parts, right, we'll be discussing all these things. So here what we are doing is we are having continuous assignment to the out data type. Variable out, which is of net data type, and the other two inputs which they are using is ANDing of I1 and I2. So by default, you should remember that the values are net data type. So this is how assign is used. Now here, assign was the keyword and the list of assignments what we had. So we have assigned out, which is equal to I and I2. Now here you can see that the other parameters are not specified. So what does this imply is the drive strength is optional and delay is optional. If you want, you can provide. If you don't want, you can provide. So in previous, say module 2, I guess, we had discussed regarding what are the different drive strength, like weak 0, weak 1, strong 0, strong 1. So we had discussed these things, right? So that is the specification we have. So here, by default, the drive strength is strong 1 or strong 0. And the delay value is also optional. It basically specifies the delay on the assignment statement. So that also we'll be discussing in coming forth sessions. So this is the syntax. Assign. The optional part is drive strength and delay. And last is the list of assignments. So that is what we observed here. Assign. This is the assignment list what we have. So out is being assigned with the value of I and I1 and I2. Now here, there are a few more things what we have to keep in mind when we're using the continuous assignments. So when you're using the continuous assignments, few characteristics what we have to remember. What should be the left-hand side of the assignment? The left-hand side of the assignment must always be a scalar or a vector net. So this is important. Net. It should be net data type. So first of all, it should be net. It can be scalar or it can be vector. Or another thing is there, that is concatenation of the scalar and vector nets. So it is net data type. It can be a concatenated version of scalar and a vector net. So left hand side should be. So that is what we are specifying this part. Okay. So here what we have, left hand side, this is net data type. This is right hand side. So we'll just check what can be the right hand side part of it. So this net data type can be of scalar in its nature, or it can be a vector in its nature. So scalar in the sense, so here we haven't specified anything. So by default, it is 1 bit. It is 1 bit. So if it is 1 bit, it is scalar in its nature. Okay. Now, if it is more than one bit, then it turns out to be vector. That is, here we can see. So we have assign ADDR is the identifier, 15 is to 0. So it has 16 bits. So this implies that this is a vector. This is a vector. And it is, since it is on the left hand side, it should be of net data type. And we haven't used that wire this thing, right? So it is by default net data type. Okay. So that is what they have specified here. The left hand side of the assignment, should be a net data type. It can be scalar or a vector or concatenation of both. So this one again we'll be discussing later because this is another concept. What is a concatenation with respect to these things? So next we have so continuous assignments are always active. So what does this mean is now here if we just observe, we have I1 and I2. If any one of these change anywhere in the code, so then the output will be changing accordingly. So what this makes? This makes the assignment an active statement. No matter where you are changing it, it gets reflected over there, reflected in the output. So here the assignment expression is evaluated as soon as one of the right hand side of the operand changes and the value is assigned to the left hand side of the net. Now what should be the right hand side of operands? That is what we can just check. It can be a register data types or net data types, or it can be a function call which is returning a value. So here right hand side should be either register data types or net data types, or it can be function calls, those are returning the values. Now here again, registers and net data types, they can be just one bit, that is scalar, or more than one bit, that is vector. So here, so this is example of both being scalar, that is right hand side, and both are, say if I have, we have defined it as net data types, both will be the net data types. Here we can see that assign ADDR 15 is to 0. So this is a 16 bit identifier. This is identifier ADDR, which is of 16 bits. So here we can observe that is vector in its nature. Now on the right hand side, if you just observe, we have ADDR bits 15 is to 0. So this is actually XORing operation. Then ADDR 2 bits 15 is to 0. So you are XORing both these 16 bits each. So this is also a vector quantity. This is also vector in its nature. Now here is an example of a concatenation. So we'll look later into this. So here you can just see how it is provided. Assign in curly braces, you have C out and sum 3 is to 0. So which is equal to actually what? A, which is of 4 bits, added with B, which is of 4 bits, and C, which is just 1 bit. So you'll be getting the overall result, and those will be stored, carry will be stored here, and sum will be stored here. So this is concatenation operation, which is having the assign statement. So here, major concern was to look at the right-hand side of the this assign statement. So here, right-hand side, it is net data type. Here, if we are under net data type, it can be again scalar or vector. It can be register data type. It can be scalar or vector. But this side, right, the left hand side of the assignment operator of the assignment, this thing, it should be a net data type. It cannot be a register data type. Now the delay values can be specified for assignments in terms of the time units. Now these are basically, for example, if I just happen to observe here, what I have assigned out I1 and I2. Now, what I want to do is I want to assign if some changes happen in I1 or I2 or both, then that change has to be reflected in out. Say I want that change to be reflected after 10 time units of the system. So you can specify that delay along with this assignment statement. You can specify the delay along with the assigned statements. So what this does is, if I1 changes, for example, if I1 changes, now when I1 changes, what happens? This statement gets executed and that result has to be updated to out. So, but what happens is, it will not be updated immediately. It will be updated after 10 time units. After 10 time units. So that is the delay values what you will be specifying. Okay. Moving further, now previously what we did, so we used to write in your gate level modeling, right? You wrote wire and then what is the identifier for that wire out. Now if I have to use the assignment, continuous assignment, how do we do? We write it assign out and what are the operator operands we'll be using. So this is your regular continuous assignment. You're doing regular continuous assignment. So imagine the same thing in your C programming. Say how we write, what we do is we'll be writing something as so it is like you have int a, and after that you are like you are assigning something to that variable. You are assigning some value to that variable. So here also the same thing, like what you did, you wrote it as wire out. Okay. And for that out, you have to assign some value. So in order to assign, you have to use the assign keyword. In one ended with in two. So something in this form you have written over there. So it is somewhat in this form. Now in C programming, can I combine both? I can combine both, right? It is like int a and assign the value here itself. Assign the value here itself. So in the same way, I can have the same operation done. That is called as implicit assignment. Is termed as implicit assignment. So if I come back here, so this is the example what I took. So it is like writing int a and a is equal to some value. Now here wire out, assign out is equal to this one. So this is your regular expression, what you are regular this thing what you are using. Now we can achieve the same thing wherein assignment, continuous assignment is implicit. That is, no need to specify or use the keyword assign. So implicitly it defines, like it is like default kind of thing which is present. So it is like you have written wire out and you have used the assignment operator in one and in two. So what this does is, this implicitly assigns value to out. So it is equivalent to this code what is present here. So that is what implicit continuous assignment means. So you are assigning, assigning a value. Implicitly, you are doing it. So here you are specifying, this is not implicit. This is not implicit because you are specifying it. You are specifying that you have to assign out with the value of in one and in two. But here what you are doing is you are writing the variable and directly you are assigning it without the use of this keyword in this case. So that is implicit continuous assignment. Okay. So we had the discussion regarding continuous assignments, and then we had the discussion regarding implicit continuous assignments. So instead of using the keyword every time assign, so we can do it in this form also. So next we have delays. Now, what are the delays what we have to specify? Now, don't get confused with the previous this thing, gate delays, what we have discussed. It is somewhat similar, but here it is related to the assignment delays. Here it is related to the assignment delay. So after what amount of what time unit the values have to be assigned to the the left hand information, that is the left hand net data type. So after how many time units it has to be assigned. So first one which we have is regular assignment delay. So we have actually three kinds: a regular assignment delay, implicit continuous assignment delay, and net declaration delay. So let us look at it one by one. So regular assignment delay is just to recall what we have. If I have to use assign, if I use the keyword assign and then specify the parameters. So here that is this example. So we have the keyword assign. We have the left hand side and the right hand side of this assignment statement. So what this is your regular assignment syntax what you are using. This is a regular assignment syntax what you are using. So if you specify delay along with this, it turns out to be the regular assignment delay. So here you use the keyword, then you specify how many time units the delay has to be there, then out, and then the rest all things are same. So only extra parameter which has come in as compared to the previous one is this one, that is #10. So what does this imply? If any of these changes in one, in two, or both change, then after 10 units of time, 10 time units, the assignment should be happening. The assignment should be happening to out. Okay. So in your regular assignment itself, you are specifying the delay. So that is in this statement. So this is your regular assigned statement what you started off. So in this one, you add the delay. So it turns out to be the regular assignment delay. Now, let us see what happens when there are some changes in N1 and N2. So there is one special thing what we have to look out. So that we'll just check out through the figure. So there is a timeline. So that is 10 to some 85 or 90 time units is specified. So initially, let us assume that output is not known. So at first instance, N1 and N2 are there. So let us start from the 10th time unit. Now here, so if I start at 0th time unit and I got to know that N1 and N2 are 0, 0. So 0, 0. What is the result? 0 and 0. So immediately it will not be assigned to this one. Immediately it will not be assigned to this one. Only after 10 time units it will be assigned. So that is what is being displayed here. So I'll from 0th time to the 10th time unit, it is unknown. But at 10th time unit, what happens is output will be 0. 0 and 0 will be equal to 0. So that is what is happening. Now here, in the next 10 units, there is no change in N1 and N2. Previously also it was 0. Next 10 units also it is 0. Now here, from 20th unit, right, you can see that N1 has changed to 1 and N2 has changed to 1. So there is change in both. There is change in value of both. So when there is change in value of both, then what should happen? After 10 time units, the computation should happen, or the computation should happen and the result should be stored in the out after 10 time units. So here the change has happened at 20th. But here you can see that still the output is 0. 1 and 1 is 1. So in this area, it is not 1. But it is 1 only after 10 time units from this point. From 20th plus 10. So this it is 30, this thing. So during this one, out is 1. Now from this point to this point, N1 and N2 are not changing. But at 60th time unit, what happens is N1 has become 0. in one has become zero, whereas in two is retaining its previous value. Now, if there is change in any one or both, then the estimation happens and then the value is assigned to the out. Now, here what we have 0 and 1, what is the value? Value should be 0. But this value will be assigned after how many time units? It will be assigned after 10 time units. So at 60th time unit, in 1 has changed to logic 0. Now, after 10 time units, it comes to it changes and the output changes to 0. Now here, if we just observe again in this location, it is same, therefore output remains same. But at 80th time unit, you can see that in one has changed its value. But what is happening? It is retaining its value only for 5 time units. It is retaining its value for only 5 time units. But there is a change which has happened over here. But there is a change. So because in one has changed, it will estimate in one and in two. The result is zero in one and in two because there was change in this one, change in this parameter. So this, both are one. So the result is both are one. So the result is one. But what is happening is before 10 units of time is completed, before 10 units of time is completed. So here it has changed. At 80th, this thing, it has changed. So at 90th time unit, that is plus 10, there should be a change in the out. Now, but at the same time, what is happening is, here you can see that it was 1 and 1, output was 1. But after 5 time units from that change, again it changes to 0. So again, there is a change over here, change over at 85th time unit. So, but what happens is, now recent values are what? It is 0 ended with 1. So when it is 0 ended with 1, what is the result? It is 0. So at 90th time unit, what happens is these new values actually affect the previous value. So at 90th time unit, because of change over here, but new value which is present over here, because of this one, the assignment will be 0. And again, after 85, this thing, 95, again, the value will be 0 because that retention will be happening over there. So here, what is the case? Change has happened over here at the 90th, this thing, what will be the value? So that is the intention. So in this case, the change in IN1 is not retained for 10 time units. It is retained only for, say, half of it, only for 5 time units. So if this is the case, then new values which are present, those will be utilized for estimating the final value of the out. Assignment will be happening. Assignment will be happening, but it will be happening based on the new value which we have because they have changed. So this is the case what we had to discuss. Rest all is your normal this thing what we have. This is one special condition that we have to check out. Okay, so that is what they have specified in this thing. When signals IN1 and IN2 go high at time 20, out goes to high 10 time units later, that is at 30. So that is what they are specifying. Here it changes, so it changes at this point. So that is what they have discussed in this entire point. So this is with respect to regular assignment delay. Now we have another one termed as implicit continuous assignment delay. Now previously we discussed implicit assignment, right? So that is this case. So what is this implicit assignment? We are not using the keyword assign in this case. So we have wire out is equal to in one and in two. So this is implicit assignment. And if we provide delay in this statement, right? we term it as implicit assignment delay. What we have, implicit continuous assignment delay. So that is what we'll be getting over here. So we had wire out in one and in two. So this is implicit statement, implicit assigned continuous assigned statement. If you're adding the delay for this one, it is implicit continuous assignment delay. It operates the same way what we have discussed above. Now this is same as writing in this form. You write it as wire out assign out in one and in two, and you're specifying this one. So this is nothing but the above discussion what we did, that is this is regular assignment delay. This is regular assignment delay. This one is implicit continuous assignment delay. So next we have net declaration delay. So any query around here? So a net declaration delay. So what does the term itself tells that you provide the delay information when you are declaring the net value. The name itself specifies this. So you provide the delay information when you are declaring the delay. So here you can see that what you had. So we are using the assign statement and we are providing the delay information. And here implicitly, we are using the assign statement, and in this statement we are providing the delay. So if you just look at this observation, what you're doing is you are declaring a net data type of for out, and then you are assigning the delay over here. So it is like a combination of these two. That is, when you're providing this information, right, you provide the delay information. That is, you write it as wire hash 10 out. That is, when you're declaring it, at that time you provide the delay information. So delay information is provided during the net declaration. So here you can see that wire out is the declaration. You are not putting any assignment over here. You are not writing it as is equal to in one and in two, then it turns out to be implicit continuous assignment delay. Whereas in this case, if you just observe what you have, wire out, only the declaration, in between you provide the delay information. So this is net delay, what you are providing, net declaration delay. And after that, you use the assignment statement. So this one is nothing but similar to this part, what you are doing. Assign 10, hash 10 out. Okay. So you had three things. If you're using your continuous assignment statement, that is assign, wire. So there you provide the delay. So which is termed as your continuous assignment delay. This is your continuous assignment delay. Next one, implicit assignment delay. That is, you don't use the assign keyword, but while declaring and assigning itself, it is happening. So here no assign, but no assign state keyword is there, but you are providing out is equal to in one and in two. So this is implicit continuous assignment. Net declaration, in the declaration itself, only you provide the delay, but don't use any assignment over here. If you use assignment, then what happens is this turns out to be implicit assignment delay. It will not be called as net declaration delay. Don't provide that assignment. If you don't provide, then it will be net declaration delay.